The following is a presentation of Seaside Community Baptist Church.
You know, when we look into the Word, we find so many little short phrases when you study God's Word. And I think a lot of us miss those when we're reading God's Word. We miss some of those short phrases that can really penetrate our hearts and give us a special touch from the Lord. And I just want to challenge you this morning from the Word of God. I want to challenge you in your Bible reading. And I want to challenge you, if you're here this morning struggling with your faith, I want to challenge you about the resurrected Savior, Jesus Christ, the gospel message of Him coming and dying on a cross and raised again the third day, which we commemorate today. And is seated at the right hand of the Father, and so I want to really challenge you this morning in some way. We can learn a lot from these little phrases, as I mentioned, and these short, pithy little statements called aphorisms that you find in the Scripture. And I'm a little nervous, so I need a piece of string to play with. And so we're going to turn in God's Word this morning to John chapter 20, and I'm going to read to you in just a moment, but I want to introduce you to this piece of string. Years ago, we went to Kedji a lot with our family to Kedji Makujik Park, and we were out one day with the interpreter in the hemlocks and hardwood section, and she got us to all get down on our knees, actually, around in a circle, and she took a piece of string like this, and she put it on the ground like that in a 1 square foot area around the things that were there. And then she proceeded to point out what was growing and living within that little section. You know, I never forgot that as an illustration, that we miss so much detail so many times. We can walk in the forest, we can walk in the woods, we can be with our family, we can be in a conversation, and we can so easily miss some of the little details that can really speak to us in the midst of a moment like that. So I want to take that string this morning, and I want to tie it around John chapter 20, verses 1 to 10. And I want us to inspect some of the short little sayings that John says there for us. So let's turn to John chapter 20 and read the first 10 verses. I'm going to read them for you, and you follow along if they're available to you. And that's John chapter 20, reading from verse 1 to 10, and then we'll pray. Now, the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early while it was still dark, and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. Then she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciple, whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Peter therefore went out and the other disciple and were going to the tomb. So they both ran together, and the other disciple outran Peter and came to the tomb first. And he, stooping down and looking in, saw the linen cloths lying there, yet he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb, and he saw the linen cloths lying there and the handkerchief that had been around his head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded together in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who came to the tomb first went in also, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not know the Scripture that he must rise again from the dead. Then the disciples went away again to their own homes. Let's pray together. Father, I just ask you this morning to remove me from the scene, Lord. Let us just hear your word. I pray, God, that each person gathered here this morning would hear from you this morning, that I would hear from you, Lord, from this precious word that we inspect and look at today. Bless each family represented here. Touch our hearts, Lord, afresh and anew as we celebrate together around your word on this Resurrection Sunday, 2017. We thank you for life. We thank you for family. We thank you for the church. We thank you for the Holy Spirit. Most of all, we thank you for our Savior, Jesus Christ, who died in our place and took our penalty for our sins upon himself so that we might be set free and live forever. God, I just thank you this morning for your love that drew a plan of salvation like that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All four gospel writers write these words the first day of the week at this place, Resurrection Day, the Lord's Day, the first day of the next week following the Passover, the event of Christ's death we celebrated on Friday. It's good that they recorded that for us. It's important. It was the first day of the week. And the four gospel writers are not always the same. You know, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they vary quite a bit in their stories. What stories they include, what stories they don't include about Jesus and his time with them, that 3.5 years that they spent together. But perhaps some of the ones that are repeated all in all the Gospels would come across to us as being most important for us. For example, outside of the resurrection account, which is in all four of the Gospels and covers almost half of John's Gospel, if you start at chapter 12, And it covers more than one-third of Matthew, Mark, and Luke are given to the resurrection. How important is the resurrection for us? How important is the death of Christ on the cross? How important is the suffering that he went through? How important is his blood being shed for us on that Passover time on the Jewish calendar? How important is that for us? I would say it's inestimably important. We could never reach the greatness of the importance of it. But outside of the resurrection accounts in all four Gospels, there's only one miracle. Only one other miracle that's included in all four Gospels, and that's the miracle of the feeding of the 5,000. Interesting. They all tell of miracles, but they don't all tell the same miracles. All four of the Gospels refer to the coming, the promise of the coming in Isaiah 40, all four Gospels talk about that passage at the very beginning of the Gospels. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. The Spirit of God knew that Christ's coming was of the utmost importance for us. And I think also that repetition is a great teacher. I think having four Gospels, not one, we don't realize how blessed we are to have four accounts. I was a policeman for about 9 years of my life, back in the 60s and 70s when I was young. And one thing about a car accident was it usually happened at an intersection. Most of them did. And many times you'd get witnesses. Well, to me, reading the Gospels is like an accident at a corner, and there's four witnesses. Matthew's on one corner, Mark's on another corner, Luke's on another corner, and John's on another corner. And they're all telling the story from their perspective. As they walked with Jesus, they're telling us the story of what they saw, what they experienced, how they felt. And it's repeated. Some of the stories repeat it over and over again. And I believe also that we need to memorize Scripture. Could I challenge you this morning for this coming year, till next Resurrection Sunday, that you get into memorizing Scripture. I believe it's so important for us. It was the first day of the week, John writes. The first day of the week. Perhaps it's important that he wrote that there because this is the beginning of a brand new thing. A brand new thing. Even though Jesus talked about it and talked about it again and again, like for example, in Matthew 16, he said that he must go to Jerusalem, he must be persecuted, he must die at the hands of the rulers, and then he would rise again on the third day. They didn't hear it. It's like they were deaf. They couldn't believe that this leader that they were following across the countryside from Galilee to Jerusalem and back again, that he was going to die. That wasn't supposed to happen. So when he died, it was something new to them. They couldn't fathom it. They couldn't figure it out. But when he rose again, they weren't ready for that. But it started something new. The Sabbath was Saturday, but Jesus rose on what we know as Sunday, which became known as the Lord's Day, even during their time, because we read in Revelation, John was in the Spirit on the island of Patmos on the Lord's Day. He died at the end of Passover week. He arose again on the first day, and it was a brand new thing that started. And we read more of it in Acts chapter 2, of course, and then on and on how the church grew. Theologian D.A. Carson says in his commentary, the reason is disputed, but it may have been to do with the desire to present the resurrection of Jesus as the beginning of something new, this rising on the first day. I subscribe to that reason, something new. We celebrate this morning something new. We could become blasé about it. Because really, many of us, like myself, I've walked with the Lord now for 42 years. So maybe it's not new anymore. But it needs to be. It needs to be. No matter how long you've been walking with the Lord, you need to sense something new from Him every day. Great is His faithfulness every morning. It's new. In Lamentations. I line these up. I'm a lining up person. My wife can tell you about that. That's her sitting down there near the back with Mrs. Killam. Elaine. I finally got it. Sorry, Elaine. I lost it for a minute. But I see the new covenant, baptism, the Lord's table, and the Lord's day lining up with the old covenant, the rite of circumcision, the Passover, and the Sabbath day. So it was the first day of the week. Now I want to move on because I'm looking at these short sayings. And now in the very next second line down, and this is my main point this morning, is while it was still dark. While it was still dark. Remember, we got a string around this little piece of Scripture, and we're inspecting it, and looking at some short, pithy little sayings. While it was still dark. You know, no other gospel writer says that. Only John. Matthew, Mark, and Luke, they don't say, while it was still dark. They don't refer to the fact that it's still dark. My father might have called it gray dawn. That's what he referred to it, when the sun is not up yet and it's still rather dark, but there's a light showing from the east, from the eastern sky. But while it was still dark. Well, when I think about that in terms of John's gospel, and this will be my main point this morning, is that about this darkness, that it's significant for us as we read this. This is John's gospel. John makes a strong emphasis on light and dark. And I want you to hear me this morning. I want you to hear God this morning on this subject. Darkness versus light. Light versus darkness. This seems to be written in here as a comment on John's perspective of what he saw in Jesus' life and what he now was feeling with Jesus dead in the grave, in the tomb. While it was still dark. Remember, if you look through John's gospel, he speaks about light 23 different times, and he speaks about darkness about 7 times. If you read in 1 John, he begins again talking about light and dark, light and dark, light and dark. It's expressions that John uses over and over again. The other gospel writers don't. John, in John's gospel, Jesus is self-described as, "I am the light of the world," in chapter 8 and chapter 9. In both cases, they signify something for us. They provide us a great contrast to the context that they're given in. First, a woman caught in adultery, and he tells her, "I am the light of the world." And then a man blind, and he makes the statement again, "I am the light of the world." There's two kinds of darkness given there for us. There's the darkness of immorality, of emotion and spiritual darkness. But there's also, in the man who was born blind, there's this physical darkness that we're drawn into in the two stories. And back in John 1, he got right to his light-darkness theme. He said, "In him," speaking about Jesus, "was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it." And then in John 3, one of the most famous passages of the Bible, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Very soon after that, we read in those verses, "The light has come into the world, but men love darkness better than light because their deeds were evil." Evil things are done in dark places. You've noticed that, I'm sure. Your experience in life has given you that, I'm sure. Evil things are done in dark places. Again, going back to my police experience, that was my experience. That many dark things, many horrible things happened in dark rooms, in dark places. But then, as we move on, looking at this subject, if we were to go to 1 John, we'd find in 1 John chapter 2, he's speaking about a person who is not in the light, and he says it this way, "He does not know where he is going because the darkness has blinded his eyes." Think about that saying for a minute. How does darkness blind you? But that's what John writes. He does not know where he's going because the darkness has blinded his eyes. The person without Jesus Christ in their life doesn't know where they're going because the darkness has blinded their eyes. What a fascinating statement to me. You know, living until I was 28 years old without Jesus Christ as my Savior, I lived in a lot of darkness. I know all about spiritual, emotional brokenness. I know all about the darkness that's around us. I've lived it. I've experienced it. And young people especially, stay away from that. Stay with Christ. Follow Jesus all the days of your life. He will keep you in the light. And you won't experience that horrible darkness of immorality and emotional suffering and pain. There's enough of that without going into that kind of sinful lifestyle. But John wrote, "While it was still dark." And we've already spoken about the proclamation that Jesus made, that "I am the light of the world." But then when you look into John 12, and we're not going to turn there, but I'm going to just give you the verse that he gives in verse 46. He says, "I have come as a light into the world, that whoever believes in me should not abide in darkness." So John, through his gospel, is talking about light and dark. Light and dark. And there's something important about that for us, and I'm going to get to it in just a moment, because here he says, "While it was still dark." This emphasis on light and darkness and this statement in this passage is no accident in the writing. John, under the guidance of the Holy Spirit, leading his thoughts to write them down for us. Wrote these words, and they have huge implication for you and for me. I ask you this morning, do you know the light of the world? Do you know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? He died for you. He rose, and we celebrate it today for you and me. He died for us. He took our sins. We could not work our way to heaven. We can't be good enough to satisfy a holy God. And he provided a way of escape. He provided a sacrifice, an atoning sacrifice, to pay the price for us. You see, the reality is around us that many more people know about God than those who know God. There's a difference. You can know about God. You can see and believe even that God's done something in our world, that the world has to have been created by what is called an intelligent being. But you can still not know God. John is talking in all of his writing about people that would believe in the Jesus that saves, the Jesus that died, the Jesus that rose again for us. People who do not know the Savior are still in darkness, and they need the light. So maybe you've caught on to why John wrote this while it was still dark. It was because, to John's mind, Jesus was still in the grave. And as he reflected on everything that happened, he wrote it down, realizing at that point in his life, when he, that morning, on the first day of the week, it was still dark, really dark, because his Savior, his leader, his rabbi, the man he had followed and been discipled under for the last 3.5 years, was dead in the grave. It was pretty dark for John. He didn't know that Jesus had already come alive. He didn't know that Jesus was not there. And when the ladies went to the tomb and they found the tomb empty, they were alarmed, and they came back and they told Peter and John. Because John is this, all theologians agree that the other disciple who's referred to here, whom Jesus loved, is John writing about himself. They came back and they said, they've taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him. John, hearing that, would have thought, oh, no, more trouble. What's happening now? This pervading darkness would be over his whole being. But John didn't know. Jesus had risen. He's risen. He's alive. You know, to me, the resurrection, this day that we celebrate today, is the pivot point of history. It's the most important moment in all of history. You know, the fulcrum is the thing that sits underneath a lever. And that fulcrum is the balance point for a seesaw, for example. Children know about seesaw. We all know about seesaws. They got other names you might have grown up with. But that fulcrum, that point, that pivot point in history is the cross and the resurrection. All that is peace, all that is love, all that is forgiveness, all that is grace, all that is mercy, all hinges right there on Jesus Christ. It is the pivot point of history that we celebrate this morning. Darkness is defeated for all those who will believe. And so you can see John's point here. Up to that moment, it was still dark. But he's going to find out in just a moment that the light has come. And so we're going to move on to quickly towards the conclusion of this message. And we're going to see where it takes John. It says, Peter therefore went out and the other disciple, and they were going to the tomb, so they ran together. And the other disciple outran Peter and came to the tomb first. And he, stooping down and looking in, that is John, stooping down and looking in, saw the linen cloths lying there. And yet the text tells us he did not go in. And I thought about that. Remember, we're talking about these short, pithy little sayings with a string around John chapter 20, inspecting these little phrases, these words. He did not go in. And I thought about that. Why did he not go in? I suggest to you, John, in his confusion over this moment right then, it's still dark. He's been told that they've taken the Savior away, and the tomb, the stone is rolled away, and Jesus is not there. And this alarms him, and he's afraid. He goes to the edge of the tomb hole and looks in, but Jesus is not there, and he can't step in because he's afraid. Perhaps you're afraid. Perhaps you have some fears this morning. Maybe you're facing something in your life. Like, we got some news in our family yesterday that was pretty alarming to us. I'm not going to share about it with you, but it just alarmed us. My wife didn't sleep well last night because of it. It troubles her. It troubles me. But maybe the very message of the gospel of Jesus Christ makes you afraid. You know, when I was, before I became pastor of a church, I was the chaplain at Halifax Airport for 4 years. That was my first ministry. I started in this ministering full-time pretty late in my life. And I was 44 years old when I went out to the airport as chaplain. And that's when I first met Elaine and Colin, was through that ministry out there. But, you know, we had a man, a commissionaire, who worked in the office. And he would come up and see me sometimes. But he wouldn't come in the chapel. He'd come to the door. He'd say, "Good morning, Frank." I'd say, "Come on in." No, I don't come into places like this. The chapel office and the chapel, a little church room. He wouldn't come in. He said, "I'm afraid to come in." He said, "I don't go to churches." So maybe you're here this morning and you have some fear about this message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I think John was afraid, and he did not go in. But along comes Peter, and Simon Peter caught up, and he went right into the tomb. He ran right in. That's what Peter's like, if you read about Peter in the Gospels. And he saw the linen cloths lying there, and the handkerchief that had been around his head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded together in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, this is John again now, the other disciple who came to the tomb first. And John, he's the writer of this gospel. He's telling us about this. And he's writing it in the order in which it came. Remember, it was the first day of the week. It was still dark. He got to the edge of the tomb hole, and he wouldn't go in. But now Peter ran right in, and then the other disciple who came to the tomb first, he stepped in also. And I love this next phrase. He saw and believed. He saw and believed is the next statement that he makes. Think about that for a minute. His light came on. The reason Jesus isn't here is because he's come alive. And I believe it. He believed it. He hadn't seen Jesus yet, but he believed it. That's powerful to me. That makes me smile. Jesus is alive, and I believe it. He says to himself, I know what's happened. I know what's happened. He's alive. He told us over and over again, and we didn't hear it. He told us he would rise again. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive forevermore. Jesus was resurrected from the grave to save you and me. And for these last 2,000 years, he's been in the business of saving people. And John realized it right then. Here is the gospel in this resurrection story. Without Christ, we live in spiritual darkness. Do you understand that? Do you believe that? Without Christ, we live in spiritual darkness. We may be afraid to enter into the salvation thing. We may be afraid to get down on our knees and pray, "Oh, Lord Jesus, forgive me for my sins." We may be afraid of that. But knowing his resurrection power personally, trusting in him, giving up on yourself and relying on him, it means light and eternal life for all those who would believe. And I would just challenge you this morning as you're here. I don't know. You see, I'm a stranger to you. Most of you, 95% have never met me. So I can say what I like. Because I'm going to leave here and Jerry or all of those guys on the board, Pastor Kommel, I can say what I like. And then I'm gone. So I would challenge you this morning. Jesus is alive. He loves you. And he's died for you and for me. And we need light. We need his life that he gives for us. You could take the short sayings of this passage and you could summarize them, and they would be something like this. Of these whole 10 verses, on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, they ran to the tomb. John did not go in, then he saw and believed. That's a summary of this whole passage. He saw and believed. And I ask you, have you believed yet? Have you trusted him? I leave that with you this morning. Let us pray. Father, thank you so much for your word. Thank you for the power of your word. Your word is able to speak to our hearts even now, today, right here in this place. Lord, I pray that if anyone is here this morning without you as their Savior, that you would, they're here because you ordained that they'd be here. They listen because you ordained that they listen. Now, Lord, help everyone to be committed to you, to give our hearts and our lives to you for every day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you for joining us, and we hope you've been blessed by today's teaching. We hope you would join us weekly in pursuing God through his word. If you would like to learn more, please join our discipleship school. You can find us at seasidecommunity.org, YouTube, or Facebook. We always enjoy our listeners' feedback, so send your comments and prayer requests to info@seasidecommunity.org. We would love to hear from you. And now, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you always.